powerful psychedelic trip? The myth slayer Scott Mason joins us today, and he will share his revelations from his transformative, mythic-level psychedelic journey. I am your host, Catherine Bell of Experiential Dreamwork, and welcome to the Dream Journal. So there's levels, but a minute's time is keenly found. We are not alone. In the words of Carl Jung, who looks outside dreams, who looks inside awakens. Today's music is called Olmsted, created new for you by my radio partner, Rick Kleffel. I am your host, Catherine Bell of Experiential Dreamwork, and welcome to the Dream Journal. The Dream Journal is also a weekly podcast. Please subscribe, rate, and review, but most importantly, tell your friends. Archives are available at Apple Podcasts and Spotify, and also at ksqd.org/the-dream-journal. We are also on PRX, so look us up there. Pretty soon I'll be releasing 30-minute excerpts, hoping to get people interested in carrying the show on other radio stations, as well as, you know, we have our KCXU broadcast partner in San Jose, but let's expand the dream. So I'm just going to take a moment to say personal dream work. I have been going through a series of nightmares, and they have finally shifted. They have broken, and it seems like that there is hope after all. Huge tsunami dream. I'm down under the water, and a man reaches out. I take his hand, and he leads me back up to the surface. So, phew. Thank you, dream maker. Okay. I'd like to say hello to Scott Mason. Hello.
Catherine Bell, hello. I'm so glad your nightmare period seems to have broken.
Yep. You know, they can happen. And when there's big transformations going on, I'll say I think a lot of it has to do with editing my book, as in ripping out pieces of my very soul.
So what is the nightmare? Editing the book or what you're going through at night?
Oh, a little bit of both, I say. But, you know, it's like it's all to the good. And now I'm up and happy about the editing process. I'm like, okay, I'm on board. Something shifted inside and I'm ready to go. So it just took a little inner work. So
Know that what you are having as a nightmare through editing that book will be a very pleasant dream that I have when I finally get to read it.
Good. Oh, that's so sweet. Oh, so Scott Mason, he is a guest who's been on several times. He's just one of my favorite guests of all time. Absolutely. And let me just say a few words about you. We're going to talk some more about your history, but mostly we want to get right to their mythic adventure. So, recovering attorney and former C-suite exec master of the mythic, Scott Mason is a speaker and a coach who helps unhappy attorneys obliterate the myths, keeping them stagnant so they can magnetize and monetize professional freedom. He's also the host of the Webdelics podcast, the official podcast for the web's most trusted resource on plant medicine and psychedelics. So you were a lawyer, C-suite executive, and you punted it. You were like, no, thank you.
I gotta say, I think about back when I was in law school and applying for jobs as a litigator. Would I have ever imagined that I would be on this show with you talking about myths mm-hmm. and psychedelics for a living? Mm-hmm. Yet here I am, and isn't life amazing?
Isn't it? It is so amazing. So how do you want to frame this? I want this show to be your choice to go, and I'll ask questions if anything comes up, but I know that you are a master tail spinner, and I am excited to hear about your journey. If there's anything you want to give us for background, or just dive right in, the floor is yours.
Why, thank you. So I will dive back right on in, but with a little bit of a background. And by all means, Catherine, interrupt me, ask for clarification, whatever you need to do. Even argue with me if you feel like
it. Okay. Great.
That'll make it fun.
For sure.
So I will start by way of going way back to the incident in childhood that ultimately informed my entire psychedelic journey and perhaps everything that happened afterwards. I grew up in the backwoods of Kansas, and my mom worked for a dog food factory. My dad was worked for the highway patrol. We weren't fancy folks. Our really glamorous summer vacation was a trip to the relatively nearby city of Denver. And we went out for pizza one night downtown, and we were walking on one of the main streets, and there was a bookstore. And right by the cashier's desk, standing upright, was a book that had on its cover the god Helios, the Greek god of the sun. The name of the book was Delary's Book of Greek Myths, and I was captivated, thunderstruck, I would even say, Catherine, by that image of Helios. I bought the book. I still have that book to this day. And this image of Helios, and as I've gone through life, I've read about Helios, been fascinated with him wherever I have gone. It stayed with me. It's almost become a part of my identity. And when I share with you what is about to happen in the narrative, a part of this discussion that relates to the psychedelic journey, it's important to understand this because it will give a lot of what I share with you and the audience context.
Perfect. Okay, great.
So, in 2022, I was asked by a new company by the name of Webdelics, which you've mentioned, to host a podcast that it runs. And as you mentioned, Webdelics is a trusted resource for information about plant medicine and psychedelics. It is, I would say, best described as the WebMD of psychedelics. I was not from the psychedelic space, but I was an experienced podcaster. In fact, that's how you and I first met. And they were looking for someone to be a guide for an audience that might not be familiar with the world of plant medicine or psychedelics, who was relatable and who could explore this subject almost from the ground up. And I was lucky enough to be that person. Catherine, I won't lie. I initially signed up because I thought that was cool, funky, and rebellious. I had no idea what I was signing up for.
Okay.
Eventually, after hosting a series of episodes, I realized, you know, I can't be hosting 500-600 episodes of this podcast and actually getting invested in what I'm recording, you know, just thinking about the future and asking questions of these guests without ever having experienced this for myself. And so I let the folks at Webdelics know that I wanted to have a plant medicine journey. And we agreed as to where this journey should occur and who should be the guide. It was a facilitated journey. One of the things that I've learned and that I advise anyone who will ever talk to me about this subject is that these are powerful technologies. There's a book about them called Food of the Gods, and that's a very appropriate title. What they're bringing into the room is they bring in gifts that are beyond what many people appreciate until they've experienced them. And so knowing this, I wanted to make sure that I was going to be in a setting that was calm and safe and with someone that had the experience and that I could relate to, so that this wouldn't end up being some catastrophic weird thing that was not what I wanted in a way that was bad.
Yeah.
And so I just do have to say, as a preliminary matter, taking those steps, doing that research, having the conversations that I needed to have was absolutely fundamental to everything that I'm about to share with you and has illuminated and magnified the impact of this mythic journey that I unexpectedly found myself on.
Okay, that's good. Yeah.
I was originally planning on taking this journey during the summer of 2023. Now, for those who are long-term fans of your show, as you mentioned, I've been on this show before. This original journey was scheduled to occur at about the time I had a severe and sudden illness that I discussed the last time I was on your show. Yep. It was physically debilitating, and I wasn't ambulatory for a while. So we postponed the journey for a couple of months until I was well enough to really feel comfortable being in a different environment. And that's important to point out because this illness was a major trauma. And when I talk about what this journey meant to me and the state that I was in, it's hard to comprehend looking back that I even considered having the journey before this illness. I certainly needed this journey more than ever after this illness. Catherine, I would be doing the audience, the universe itself, a disservice to say anything other than the experience I had when ill was so traumatic that I felt like, even when I was still in the hospital, that a part of my soul had died. And the person who left almost felt not like an empty soul, but like someone who was grasping to figure out what was left of the soul inside, or who was this person walking around in this body. My physicality healed. My mind was fine. But my spirit, it was shaken to the core.
Wow, that's amazing.
So perhaps it was providence, perhaps it was just random luck that the journey, which involved psilocybin, commonly known as magic mushrooms, was delayed until I had had some time to recover and was in a position where I really had something meaningful that I needed to have addressed. For those who don't know, psilocybin in particular is well known as an agent that has helped people who it's right for, who feel the call, and who are in the right set and setting with the correct guide to be able to have profound positive impacts on post-traumatic stress disorder, as well as other traumatic events, which my sudden illness was. And for those who are curious, this illness's trauma was made all the worse by the fact that no one knows what it was that I got. I did catch a pathogen of some sort, and the official diagnosis is more or less infection by an unknown pathogen. But truly, no one knows what this pathogen was, why I got better.
Even now, nobody knows what it was.
No one knows. In a way, that created an ongoing trauma because at that time, I was doubting whether I'd ever be safe again.
Yeah.
Literally.
Yeah, how do you know it might come back, you know?
Yeah.
Right?
It was, you know, it hasn't, and I don't believe that it has, based in no small part because of experiences that I had during this journey. Mm-hmm. But in any event, I went, and the guide that I saw had a very specific process. His ceremony itself was to take place in a dome-like setting in a valley, and it was a quiet place that was insulated from the elements. It had a nice sort of sun window. But outside of that, it was a dome that was soundproof and that was just cool and calm and relaxing. Outside of that, there was an offering space. This particular guide suggested that before we begin any ceremonial work, that I offer a tribute to the native gods of the land. Mm-hmm. This person believed, as I've come to believe, that these plants are sacred and they need to be respected. And that includes respecting those who cultivated them and who first brought them into our world. And he said that usually I don't allow first timers to do this, but Scott, because your whole life is devoted to the study and the understanding of the mythic and of pagan gods, I think that you are someone that can truly appreciate what this is, and I'll let you do it. So I made the offering. Interestingly enough, the minute I made the offering, a hawk flew right by overhead, which I took as a sign that the offering had been accepted. And then we went up to the top of the valley, and while he was beginning to prepare the overall experience that I was to have, and by the experience, the dose of mushrooms and the potion that I was going to drink, we did have some initial sorts of discussions with regards to an intent that I wanted to have. It's advised by many who are far greater experts than me that to really maximize these experiences, developing a clear intent with someone who's an experienced guide and can help you have an intent that doesn't overwhelm you or doesn't lead to something that's horrible or that is that makes sense or, again, allows you to make the most of your experience is an integral part of interfacing with these medicines. And we did that. While we did that, I also took a small microdose of mushrooms. The intent that we decided would be mine was more or less, Spirit, show me my light. Spirit, show me my light. Mm-hmm. It felt right for me because, as I mentioned earlier, the source of light on the earth, the sun, has been my avatar ever since I was a child. And once we made that intention clear, I finished up my microdose and sat alone on the edge of this valley, overlooking the beauty, thinking about how lucky I was to be here experiencing this and how bizarre life is that a boy from the backwoods of Kansas who grew up in a fundamentalist church was here in this location doing this thing. And as I was taking in the beauty and feeling immense gratitude, the only thing that was unusual when I began to microdose was I suddenly saw two or three streaks of light in front of my eyes. And then suddenly, Helios, in my mind's eye, he was there. Now, I was not hallucinating. It was not as though I saw the image of Helios in front of me, but in my mind's eye, it was plain as day. Mm. And this is something that has stuck with me ever since, and it took me many months of thinking about to unravel. But when Helios in the chariot of the sun went by, he was so much larger than I had ever imagined. He looked nothing like I had ever imagined. He wasn't even dressed in the sort of thing you might imagine a Greek sun god to be dressed in. And he was closer to the earth and to me than I could have ever comprehended. It was a millisecond, Catherine. Mm. Then it was gone. But what that meant, how I've played with that, how I've interpreted it, what the plants were telling me, its import is hard to overestimate. Shortly after that, nothing else really occurred with regards to the microdose, except I just felt more open, I felt more creative, I felt more heart-centric, but nothing like that. But then my guide said, the sun's beginning to set, why don't we go down into the dome? And when we went into the dome, there were some rituals that occurred. And these were basically sort of things to get me ready for taking, for drinking the soup that was the dose. Some might be wondering or asking themselves exactly what the dose was. I actually chose not to inquire as to that. I wanted to just have the experience with a guide and focus on the experiential nature of it rather than the technical specifications, which to me, asking questions about like dose and that sort of thing would have felt like.
Right. Okay. Mm-hmm.
So I lay down and my eyes were covered and some gentle music was playing. And after some initial flashings of sort of stereotypical psychedelic images, sort of like these hexagonal shapes or some cards that had little faces in them that you might see that had this overall cliche psychedelic vibe, I suddenly found myself experiencing the beginning of a Greek myth, although there were elements of other myths in them. And weirdly enough, even as this myth was happening, I knew it was a myth, and I even knew the genre of myth that it was. There's a very specific type of myth called the Journey Home, and Homer's The Odyssey is the most famous example of that sort of myth. And the movie The Warriors, if anyone is familiar with pop culture, and movies like that that are about a journey home are modern day versions of that sort of myth. Mm-hmm. It's not a type of myth that I had particularly ever fixated on before. I have no idea why that particular one came up, but boy did it ever. And it began not with a Greek god, but with an Egyptian god. Like I said, my intent was, Spirit, show me my light. But there was no light. I was next to a gigantic statue of the god Anubis, the god of death. And the god of death was in the shape of a jackal. He was on a pedestal with his neck leaning forward and his snout pointing me. And it pointed me to a canal that had a long canoe on it. Around Anubis and on the other side of the canal was a city. This city only had buildings without doors. They were in shapes like pyramids, spheres, pentagrams. Not normal building shapes, but in these very severe stone geometric formations. But they were clearly buildings. They were clearly a city. The city was surrounded by mountains and then a sky. The sky, the city, the mountains, and the statue, even the waters of the canal and my skin itself were all bathed in indigo. Indigo was everywhere. It might have been a dark indigo, a lighter indigo, but indigo was everything. There was no light. But I followed what Anubis's was the message that Anubis was sending me, and went into the boat that was in the canal where Anubis's snout was pointing, and I began to stand as the canoe moved forward. In that moment, Catherine, I was overwhelmed with fear. I started to shake in my leg, and then my arms started to shake, and then my chest started to shake, and then even my abdomen started to shake, and I started to cry. I yelled out to the guide. I said, please hold my hand. What if I can't get out of this psychedelic nightmare? Mm-hmm. What if this is a bad trip and I'm stuck here forever? What if I'm allergic to mushrooms and I die? What if my spouse is called and there's nothing left of me but a corpse in this valley, in this random place somewhere, that attempted to go on a journey? He held my hand as the canal moved forward, and I realized the canal was moving out of the city and into an abyss. As the boat continued down the canal, to my left, there was a fork in the canal, and the water moved back towards the city. Catherine, I wanted to go back so badly into that city and its safety. But I couldn't. And so I continued forward. And then I went into the abyss. The city was behind me. Now, one might think that the abyss represents an infinite below, but it was wrong to think that for a single second, and that's what I'd feared, because the abyss also was infinitely high. And I realized in that moment that to find my light, I needed to be like my avatar Helios and start to rise and rise, and maybe just like Helios, the sun, would hit the top of the firmament and be at his brightest, I would find my own light that way. I saw stone walls so tall you couldn't even begin to see the top of them. And I tried to rappel up those. And eventually I got up those, and when I looked at the top, I saw that I was at only the beginning of the abyss above. I could see to the edge of the universe. I could see the Andromeda galaxy. I could see the arms of our galaxy very clearly, representing the infinite that I needed to get to if I needed to escape the indigo, because this abyss was indigo as well. And I was desperate to try and do so. Then out of the left-hand bottom corner of my personal view screen, I saw a black hole, like exist in the middle of galaxies, which you as an astrophysicist are very familiar with.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And you know that when you jump in those, presumably in real life, there's no coming back once you cross that event horizon.
Right.
But I thought that maybe my light was inside. I thought maybe the singularity that was at the center of a black hole would be my light. So I dived in and I stretched out, like they say really happens in a black hole. I didn't spaghettify and die that way, obviously, in this vision. But as I went in, I felt every bit of pain that I have ever felt in my life. Catherine, I've never kept it a secret that I was seriously physically and emotionally abused as a child. I felt every whipping. I felt every tear. I felt every slap. I felt every punch. And more. And I realized how hard my life had been, and that I had never accepted that I'd always suppressed it and tried to keep it down. And I was like, I've never been able to get past how hard my life had been, because I'd never been honest with myself or the world about how horrible it was. And so these soul cries started to happen. Eventually, after a while, my guide was like, Scott, it's time for you to leave this place. And I remember saying, but my light might be inside. He said, you have to leave, and we have to leave now. Wow. And so we did. And I was able to leave it behind. And Catherine, I'll tell you that this. I'm at peace. I feel no resentment about any of that ever since.
Wow. So
it's gone.
Just process that on a whole nother level.
I then went specifically to search for my light. I won't go through the whole thing here because it's quite long, but suffice it to say, this indigo planet that I lived on during this search had multiple levels. There were valleys that were full of forests that, again, were bathed in indigo light. These forests and these valleys had indigo mountains surrounding them. And I sometimes would be on the floor of the forest going through paths looking for my light. Then other times I would see something at the top of the trees. There was, for instance, a treetop lighthouse that I saw. And so I went up to the top of that lighthouse because inside I saw light. And I was like, this is my light. The light was the only thing that wasn't indigo, Catherine, in this whole universe I was experiencing. But when I got to the treehouse and looked and found this hut and looked inside, there was nothing there. I saw a plank that led me to a Native American teepee, and the flap was open and I could see light inside of that. I crossed that plank to get to that teepee, and then when I looked inside the teepee, the light was gone. And that kept happening over and over. I would see stone stairs taking me up to another level, which took me to another forest floor that was exactly the same, with the same trees over and over. And on a mountain or by the side of the steps, I would see that light. But when I would try and get it, it would be gone. Eventually, I got to a level of the forest floor where there were Mayan temples coming out of the forest with the flat up top of the otherwise pyramidal structure. And at the entrance to one of those pyramids, I remember there was a path, and in the base of the pyramid, again, I saw the light. I walked that pathway through a garden to get to that entrance, and I saw the most abusive and brutal boss I'd ever had in my life, one that caused me years of pain and angst, who derailed my entire career as an attorney, or at least as an attorney in the sector that I was in at that point. I remember her looking at the flowers in the garden, and then I saw suddenly that she herself was a fragile flower, and the wind blew her away. And years, over a decade of anger I have had at her in that situation, Catherine, they've gone and they've never come back. But when I went past her and into the pyramid, the light was again gone. I climbed to the top of the pyramid. There, against a mountain that was facing right next to the pyramid, almost like, it was like I was on the Inca Trail, and there was that sort of pathway against the mountain, stood my husband. But he wasn't facing me. He was facing away and bathed in indigo light, looking up at the sky. And, well, before I tell you what happens next, I'll share one thing. Periodically, I was drinking a lot of water before I began this journey, and every now and then, I would take off the mask that I was wearing to cover my eyes during the journey and go to the restroom, and then I would come back. And it was weird, when these breaks would happen, I would just snap back into the myth that I was living, even though time had passed. In the world of the myth, no time had passed at all. It picked up immediately where I had left. And so at one point, I remember being frustrated by this whole light situation. And I went to the bathroom, and then I came back and I saw my guide, and I told him, look me in the eye. And he said, okay, and he did. And, you know, Catherine, the whole thing was so surreal because we were inside this dome and it was dark except candlelight that was flickering. And I said, you have to look me in the eye. And he intently looked at me, and I grabbed him by the shoulders and I said, I have to find my light. Mm-hmm. Heaven will not stop until I find my light. It will never be satisfied until I find this light. So he said, to find it, you need to go back down and into, you know, your experience. And I did.
So, Scott, before you get to the denouement here, I mean, I'm riveted at the edge of my seat, and I'm wondering if maybe this is a time to take a breath, and we'll play a little music and do a couple station things, and we'll come back and hear what happened when you met your husband on the cliff. And then I'll hear some of your, what has come up for you around this incredibly intense experience. And I'm so grateful for you for sharing this with us, Scott.
I'm glad to be here.
Yeah. Okay. Fabulous. So this is Scott Mason, WebDelics podcast, and myfreedomrocks.com and webdelics.com. And you're listening to The Dream Journal. My name is Catherine Bell, and after the break, we're going to keep going with this amazing psychedelic journey. I want to let you know that we are broadcast live from the KSQD studios in Santa Cruz and co-broadcast live in San Jose by KCXU. Okay, this is The Dream Journal. My name is Catherine Bell, and we're talking today with Scott Mason, the Myth Slayer, a former lawyer turned WebDelics podcast host and a personal voyager, about his psychedelic adventure, the mythic adventure that he experienced, and what it meant to him. So Scott, how are you doing?
I'm overwhelmed even as I relive the experience, and I think that that's something that a lot of people feel. These things shatter your your soul or your foundations to such an extent that it can be hard to not relive them when you think about them. But that's also an incredible gift.
Yeah, exactly. And I'm so honored that you're sharing here first on the Dream Journal your experience. It's a big deal to share these inner journeys, just as it's a big deal to share dreaming. And there's a lot in common with these experiences. And I want to just recap a little, if I may.
Please.
Okay. So in Scott's adventure, his intention was, Spirit, show me the light, show me my light. And then he found himself in a place with intense indigo colors, and Anubis, the god of death, pointing him toward a canal. Went through the canal into the, and then over into the abyss, and then went in search for his light. And searching for the light, he started to integrate some of the horrible things that he had experienced as a child: abuse, shame. And then experiencing resolution for some waking life, adult experiences of brutality, and of that brutal boss who became fragile in your vision and then just blew away, just ending those decades of resentment.
Yes.
And then as you came toward, why don't you set the scene? You came toward a cliff, right? At the edge of a mountain? Tell us the scene.
Yes.
Yeah.
So I climbed up after seeing that boss through a Mayan temple that was up against a mountainside. And to recap one detail, the Mayan temple had a flat roof. Mm-hmm. And as I went up to that mountainside, I saw my husband looking away from me by the side of that mountain, looking up at the sky. But he himself was bathed in that same indigo light. And he simply blew a kiss. Actually, he didn't blow it at me. He blew it into the sky. Mm. I saw that kiss as a Valentine, and it was the only non-indigo thing in the entire sequence outside of the light that I kept trying to touch, but I could never quite touch. And that Valentine was magenta, and it floated up into the sky and then dissipated into nothing. Mm. And I remember holding my guide's hand and telling him, not even the love of my husband can stop me from finding my light. Mm. And then at that moment, I knew what I needed to do next. Mm. And so, Catherine, I went to the top of that temple, the flat top, and I lay on my back. I held my hands out with my palms to the sky, and my feet were spread out beneath me. And suddenly I began to rise and rise and rise. And as I rose even higher into the indigo sky and into the abyss above that sky, I could see my soul beginning to extend out from my feet. Hmm. Almost like a gigantic, again, geometric shape made of ether. And the soul, as I went higher and higher, was huger and huger. It was as if I were a thumbnail and my soul were the size of the entire United States of America. I understood that I was a soul. Hmm. All my life, having grown up in a fundamentalist church, Catherine, I had been taught that a human being has a soul. It had never occurred to me that a soul could have a human being. Ooh. And in fact, that the soul has a human being. That my vastness that was truly me, that was my spirit, was beyond what I could have imagined, because I couldn't see outside of my body and assuming that the soul was contained within that. And I remember just saying, I'm a soul, I'm a soul. And then I floated and floated on and on, taking in the vastness of my soul and amazed at the insignificance of my body and how much I had cared about something so trivial. And then I came out. Mm. I never found my light or thought. And I remember being very irritated because everyone always says, if you ask a question, if you walk in with that intent, the plant medicines will show you what you've asked or they'll show you what you need to see. And I was like, well, how come that happens to everyone except me? I didn't see the damn light. But that's the power of these substances. Mm. They do show you the truth. You just may not be able to understand it. Mm. They're oracles. They're riddles. But once you understand, you'll get the depth and the power of the truth, whether you're ready to face it or not.
Mm-hmm. Well, so how has this settled in you over the months since your experience? Like, what is, and now that you've shared it with us, because, you know, of course, we know every time we touch a memory, it changes the memory. And so now you've gone through this psychedelic journey with us again. And what is alive for you now? What is coming up for you around that experience and where you are right now?
My light was my mission. One of the things that has changed and intensified, and it has increasingly intensified since this medicine journey, has been my understanding that I'm here on a mission, and that heaven, as I told my shaman, will not rest until I fulfill it. I have never felt so connected to and driven by my mission as I was on the day after and in the times since this journey has occurred. So in terms of being on this earth and understanding what I'm here to accomplish and not just letting the earth wash me by, that's changed. And Catherine, that has unlocked unbelievable power within me, unbelievable drive, but also unbelievable joy, a sense of direction, something I never had. And it's a precious gift.
Yeah. Joy and death. A sense of direction.
Yes. Ooh. Death, Anubis, the statue. Death is change. Death is transition. It was pointing me to fundamental changes that I needed to make in every sphere of my life. After the plant medicine journey, changes, for instance, in my relationships began to manifest almost immediately. Certain people I needed to have out of my life at once. And those relationships ended within weeks. Mm-hmm. And it's a number of them. Space opened up for other relationships to build. And yet, other relationships with people that I knew beforehand that I might not have understood the true depth or the meaning of our connection, those deepened or reignited in ways that I couldn't have imagined. I, Catherine, felt the need to reach out to certain people almost immediately afterwards. And in every last case, I might not have talked to them in years. They were like, I needed to hear from you. Mm-hmm. And I told them my story. People took notes, or people said, I had no idea how much I needed to hear your story, but I desperately needed to. Other people reached out to me saying, Scott, in the past week or so, I've needed to talk to you. I don't know why. And we had that conversation and they understood. That's a change. Helios, my highest self, was not what I thought it would be. All of my life, I had had ideas about what my highest self, about what Helios looked like, and what it would be, and how I would attain, and how far away it would be. It didn't look anything like what I imagined. It was closer and greater. If you view Helios as the higher self, that's also changed. So I'm stepping into my highest self more easily with an understanding that it also could be grander. And as a body, as a soul with a body, I see the expansive potential of that completely differently in much bigger terms than I might have had this not occurred.
That's huge. There's so many shifts that you've gone through. And I love the way that the shifts that have been natural, like certain friendships falling away and people just saying, oh, I was just thinking about you, I'll give you a call. And so to have this simplicity of these changes, and that yet in our day-to-day, we often don't notice what needs to change, or maybe we don't, not even aware, but somehow after this experience and really embracing the experience, instead of saying, oh, it's just a dream, it was just a hallucination, but really embracing this as my own mythic adventure, that you have like let yourself change in some really profound ways.
Beyond what I could have imagined. I also will add one final thing.
Yes.
I thought I didn't find my light. But maybe the most profound realization was that it was around me the whole time. As you know, indigo is a color on the light spectrum.
That's true. Scott, your light. I mean, I just like see this light beaming out of you. Like I feel like that you are the light, and like the whole experience of drifting up into the soul and being the soul. I am a soul. Seems like claiming your own light. I mean, I've just like been biting my tongue saying, but wait, the light, you are the light. Like this is like for me what I hear when I hear this. And if, you know, you're the one who knows whether it rings true or not because it's your experience. But I just like imagining you floating up from the top of that Aztec, that Incan temple and into the indigo sky. Like there is the light. I mean, there's even a bit of a pun for me, light as in light in spirit, like light and floating up. There's a bit of a pun there.
I will say, as to that, it's true. Mm. Every word that you said. Mm-hmm. How could I have lived my life for so long being such a fool to not see that, to be searching for this light when it was in me all along? Mm-hmm. Yet how lucky was I to be one of the people who gets to uncover the truth when you see so many people out there, just like me, looking for that light externally, but never having the chance to understand where the light, and like you just said regarding the pun, what the light really is.
Unbearable lightness of being, if we can do a literary reference. Yeah. So, and then here you are sharing your experience, and I'm sure people listening are going to really resonate with this experience and start to feel their own light and know that it is by really saying yes to death and saying yes to those painful things that happen, yes to the nightmares, that this is the way through to connect with a deeper self. And by listening to these kind of epic stories like this, we get to go on an adventure ourselves. So whether, you know, I ever do a guided meditation, psychedelic experience, or our listeners ever do, that they have a taste of this. And here you are sharing this powerful experience. And there's just something, I'm thinking of the Kansas City child and the fundamentalist church, and that you are really preaching here. You're really bringing some gospel of authenticity to people. And I really am so grateful for everything that you're sharing here today.
Catherine, regarding that, I think about the city that I left in this experience. It was all geometric shapes. It was linear. It was boxed in. It was surrounded by mountains. I did leave exactly what you were talking about behind, all of those things that keep us trapped, to be able to share, to use my gifts, hopefully, to help other people take that journey, no matter how scared they are, out of the dark and into their own light.
And, you know, if we can shine a light for each other, then what a gift. And that's, you know, part of what my motivation for the show is, to share people's journeys, and so that listeners can be inspired by their own journey that they're already going through, and to regard their life as these mythic adventure. And that's something that you really highlight for me, your dedication to the myths and your I too had an early experience of getting involved in mythology at age 10. In fifth grade, I discovered our library had a whole shelf full of books about mythology, and I was hooked. And so these stories, they speak to such a cultural you know, a cultural myth. And then the dreams become our own myths, our own inner myths. And to see myself as the heroine of my own journey is so helpful. Like, I can see how I survived all these horrible things. They should never have happened. Like, this abuse that you described should never have happened. And yet you survived, and you're resilient, and you've come back and created this life, which is a light to so many people. And that is like an inspiration to all of us.
That is deeply affecting. Mm-hmm. I could easily see you devouring those myths. And I do love the connection and the understanding of the shared language between the psychedelic experience, the dream experience, and the experience of myth when we take it in and read it.
Mm-hmm.
Feel it.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. There's something very primal, archetypal, something very core level true. So Scott, what is next for you? We're getting near the end of our hour together. These hours always go by so fast.
Yes.
And what is next for you? Let's just leave it at that. And I'm not going to leave it at that, because I'm remembering you're going to give a TED Talk.
I have two TED Talks coming up next month. One on April 6th, where I will be speaking about how Greek myths can help you become more charismatic. And then I have another one about how Greek myths can help you become an authentic leader. There are a couple of other things that I want to talk to your audience
Please.
About. First of all, you're not the only person who knows how to write, Ms. Bell. I have a 4-book series I am working on. The first part I hope to have out later this year, called Visions Dawn, and it is a mythic epic. It's a modern, futuristic sci-fi retelling of Greek myths with business and professional and leadership lessons baked in with each myth that is retold. And then I also am starting on my YouTube channel. It's a very beginning new YouTube channel, but I'm excited about where it's going. The YouTube channel is The Myth _ Slayer, a vodcast featuring certain people who will be talking about Greek myths, both as a matter of retelling and how they relate to leadership and personal and professional development. Do you know anyone who might be a good guest for that, Catherine Bell?
I do believe I'm going to be one of your early guests coming
right
up.
Yes.
I can't wait. I am so excited to return the favor. And it's always such a pleasure to share these adventures with you, Scott. And so myfreedomrocks.com, that's still a good webpage for you, right? Contact?
Very much so. Okay. And I would love to hear from anyone.
Excellent. So, Scott, it is just so delightful. So I really want to stay in touch. And, of course, we'll see you on the vodcast in a couple of weeks. Do you have links for those TED Talks? Are they going to be Zoom live or broadcast live as well? Do you know?
They will be broadcast post facto on the TED website. But follow me on my LinkedIn account or my Instagram account. My LinkedIn account is @TheMythSlayer, one word. And then my Instagram account is s.scott_Mason. And links to those, when they are finished, will appear as soon as the sponsoring institutions post them.
Well, I cannot wait. I am so excited to listen to that and just find out what amazing thing you'll be doing next.
The feeling's mutual.
All right. Take care, Scott.
Thank you.
Bye. All right. An epic adventure. Thank you so much for listening. The Dream Journal is produced at the studios of KSQD in Santa Cruz, and we are live every Saturday at 10 a.m. Pacific at ksqd.org. Or you can catch the podcast every Monday after the show. Please subscribe, rate, and review to help keep us growing. My name is Catherine Bell. To find out about my dream coaching practice, you can go to experientialdreamwork.com. Email me at Catherine@ksqd.org, KATHERINE@ksqd.org. Follow Experiential Dream Work and hashtag The Dream Journal on Facebook and Instagram to find out about upcoming shows. I'd like to thank Rick Kleffel, engineer and music creator, also Tony Rosamato and Max Deaton. Intro and outro pieces are both by Mood Science. Tomorrow morning when you wake up, take a minute to write down your dream and bring it to the next Dream Journal.
Okay. I had an old thought in the old town. 'cause there's no fool.